the fifth kind.
In 381 AD, the Roman Emperor Theodosius took a decisive step to explain to all Roman citizens the world over which narratives were acceptable and which were not.
It said that all that was fake news and that the teaching of it was to be forbidden. And so that meant that the priesthoods of those other religions, the curators of those other texts, had to hide those stories. Texts literally had to be buried in the desert to keep them safe. Others would be shared secretly in underground meetings of esoteric societies. It's a pattern that continues through history. I've been a preacher for more than 30 years. I've preached on the book of Genesis in churches all around the world, and I've trained pastors in the principles of interpreting ancient texts. And so I've long known about these anomalies in the Hebrew scriptures that point to another, more ancient story. When you read them in parallel with the source narratives of ancient Sumeria, Babylonia, Arcadia, Assyria, you realize these ancient stories are not about God. They are about other beings who've arrived on planet Earth from elsewhere and have had a hands-on involvement in our evolution as a species.
Something filthy and blooded is being dragged through the streets of Rome as crowds of people look on. Armed papal officers stand at the street corners, encouraging the crowds to cheer as the object is dragged before them into the market square. The object is a naked man. He has been in prison for 7 years. Few would recognize him as the charismatic scholar and speaker who had dazzled Europe only a few years before with his speaking tours. A friar of the Dominican order, his public demonstrations of phenomenal mental skills and his books on mental self-improvement and mnemonics had made him a popular figure in a Europe hungry for new ideas. Now, he is an object of horror. The papal guards unchain the man and fix him on a stake, upside down. One guard now pulls the man's tongue forward out of his mouth and nails it to the stake. Next, he draws a knife from its scabbard and uses it to sever the man's tongue. Other officers of the church now step forward to ignite the pyre positioned below the man's head. The crowd watches in fearful approval as Giordano Bruno goes up in flames. It is Ash Wednesday. Giordano Bruno had been held in prison for 7 years without trial in the vain hope that he might recant his heretical ideas. Such a recantation would break the spell of his popularity among a public who had flocked to his lectures and demonstrations of mental skills. It would serve as a warning to Christians throughout Europe not to stray too far from Catholic orthodoxy. In the absence of a recantation, a trial has been hurried through to allow for his public execution, which will send shockwaves through Christendom for decades to come and leave people in no doubt that the ideas of Giordano Bruno are ideas to be avoided at every possible cost. So what were the dangerous ideas that had ended the life of this brilliant Dominican friar so tragically?
Giordano Bruno was a very popular public speaker, and people would go and see him speak in the same way that people would go and see someone like David Blaine or Uri Geller or Joe Dispenza, and they would go to figure out how is he doing this, because he had these phenomenal mental skills. He was very popular with the public for those reasons, but he offended a number of stakeholding theologians, and he did that by his conversations about consciousness. He had written books on mnemonics, which is about accessing the power of human memory, and he had a great interest in raising the power of human consciousness. He had got this by probing the works of Plato and the intellectual children of Plato. And in those studies, he had reached some other powerful conclusions. He was attacked in Britain for being a follower of Copernicus, Giordano Bruno had become convinced that the planet Earth orbits the Sun, not vice versa. And that when we look into the night sky and see stars, what we're actually seeing is other suns like our own, which have planets like our own orbiting them. And that maybe those other planets are home to other people like ourselves, other life, other civilizations. And that was regarded as completely unacceptable. The classic Orthodox Christian view is that creation happened at a fixed point and created a fixed creation. Giordano Bruno had a different view, and that was that creation is ongoing from an infinitesimally zero point, as we would call it today, and that the universe is expanding infinitely.
Bruno's beliefs about human consciousness left no room for the fear of hellfire with which his opponents tried to threaten him. In fact, when his sentence was pronounced in an ecclesiastical court, he famously looked at his prosecutors and said, "I can see in your eyes that you are the ones who are afraid, not I."
Giordano Bruno's beliefs about human consciousness meant that he had no fear of heaven and hell, and that narrative with which Christian orthodoxy had manipulated so many generations of human beings. One of the theological things that Giordano Bruno said that upset the theologians was that maybe Jesus was somebody who was very aware of his consciousness and his consciousness preceding this material life and continuing after this material life. And he suggested that maybe Jesus shows us what God is like, what the source is like, not because he's different to the rest of us, but because he's the same. And so in that way, he was coming up against the powers of orthodoxy at that time. But you know, this wasn't that long ago. That execution was after the Reformation, after the Renaissance, after the birth of modern science. And yet here was this heavy-handed suppression of more speculative thought. And it sent out a powerful signal to all his followers. They'd kept him in prison for nearly 7 years in the hope that he would recant, because that would diffuse all his popularity and his following and tell his followers to stop chasing down these rabbit holes. But absent of that, they put him on trial, they executed him in this brutal way, and put that out as the warning not to read forbidden texts, not to study forbidden languages, and certainly never to bring ETs into the conversation. It's a pattern that continues through history.
In 381 AD, the Roman Emperor Theodosius took a decisive step to explain to all Roman citizens the world over which narratives were acceptable and which were not.
In 381 AD, what Emperor Theodosius did was to step into a theological debate. He really wanted to establish orthodoxy, move beyond this era of violent debates between factions within the church, and that really meant political factions within the empire as well. And he settled a theological debate that might sound like a really fine point, but what it did was have an immediate impact on all those groups that were supposedly on the fringe of Christianity, the Gnostic groups and the indigenous religions and priesthoods and sects that existed. It said that all that was fake news and that the teaching of it was to be forbidden. And so that meant that the priesthoods of those other religions, the curators of those other texts, had to hide those stories. Texts literally had to be buried in the desert to keep them safe. Others would be shared secretly in underground meetings of esoteric societies. Other information would be hidden in plain sight, encoded into literature in the form of poetry and codes. In that way, these narratives were able to survive the orthodoxy of the empire, because the emperor wanted to be quite clear that it was the empire that determined what was true and what was false, what was news and what was fake news. And that power could not rest with unofficial indigenous priesthoods. There had to be a right and a wrong, and it had to be him who decided which was which. It's a pattern that continues through history. I've been a preacher for more than 30 years. I've preached on the book of Genesis in churches all around the world, and I've trained pastors in the principles of interpreting ancient texts. And so I've long known about these anomalies in the Hebrew scriptures that point to another, more ancient story. When you read them in parallel with the source narratives of ancient Sumeria, Babylonia, Arcadia, Assyria, you realize these ancient stories are not about God. They are about other beings who've arrived on planet Earth from elsewhere and have had a hands-on involvement in our evolution as a species. These other entities in my book Escaping from Eden, I call them sky people. The glyph indicates the sky. They're people from the stars. That becomes clear as the story rolls on. They are people referred to as Anunnaki.
In the highlands district of Chichicastenango, a young Dominican friar by the name of Francisco Jimenez has arrived to serve as parish priest. Francisco is a true enthusiast for the Dominican tradition he represents. This means he has a passion for scholarship and the study of ancient books. An avid linguist, Francisco relishes the opportunity to sit down and listen to the stories of his new hosts as he learns the ins and outs of the local language. Francisco's enthusiasm and his respect for his hosts gradually wins him the trust of the local community. They are the successors of the ancient Mayans, whose culture once dominated this country in Guatemala. One day, Francisco is presented with an unfamiliar text, written in the indigenous language of Quiché. The priests of the feathered serpent, descendants of an ancient Mayan priesthood, explain to the young Francisco that this ancient Quiché text holds their story of human origins. Somehow, this text has survived the banning, burning, and burying of the 15th century. It is a story which has been told for at least 100 generations, detailing the Mayan succession of kings and explaining how the human race itself came into being. 7 years pass as Francisco navigates the nearly forgotten Quiché language and emerges with a translation into 18th century Spanish. What has emerged through his literary journey is an account of human origins which had been kept hidden for more than 10 generations. Francisco Jimenez's translation becomes known as the People's Book or the Popol Vuh.
When the Catholic forces of Portugal and Spain invaded Central and South America, they did what all colonizers do. They took over. They established themselves with a strong military force. They provided the army. They were the army. The rest were insurgents. They provided the police. They provided the education. And they shut down all other authorities within those lands. And that meant extinguishing other religions, extinguishing other priesthoods, and burying, burning, or archiving their books. So it really was an amazing turn up when Francisco Jimenez was handed the Quiché text that told a totally different story of human origins. My book, Escaping from Eden, talks a lot about the Popol Vuh because what emerged in that text was a creation account that was strangely similar to the Genesis story. And when you read them side by side, you realize what you have is a picture of a devastated planet Earth. Some kind of cataclysm has happened. It's now flooded and shrouded in darkness. And then these entities arrive. They orbit the waters and they consider how they can re-nurture life on planet Earth. And it becomes clear that what we're looking at is a planetary reboot. The story that emerges of the creation of human beings is very different from the one with which Christians of that generation were familiar. This was a story of other beings arriving from elsewhere and engineering our ancestors from the animal life that was already here. That was the story that the Catholic authorities wanted to extinguish, and yet it survived. It survived in the unknown Quiche language, and it was Francisco Jiménez who brought it back for posterity. Escaping from Eden argues that this knowledge was there, right in the roots of the Judeo-Christian tradition, but that it was suppressed. And you can see this story of suppression beginning within the pages of the Bible itself.
The Ten Commandments famously begin with the commands, "You shall have no other Elohim before me. You must not bow down to them or even depict them." A great forgetting is being commanded. Moses' successor, Joshua, repeats the same command as he inherits the mantle of leadership. He says, "This is what Yahweh, the powerful one of Israel, says. Long ago your ancestors, including Terah, the father of Abraham and Nahor, lived beyond the Euphrates River and served other powerful ones. Now fear Yahweh and serve him with all faithfulness. Cut yourselves off from the powerful ones your ancestors worshipped beyond the Euphrates River and in Egypt, and serve Yahweh. Choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve. Will it be the powerful ones your ancestors served beyond the Euphrates River, or the powerful ones of the Amorites in whose land you are living? As for me and my household, we will serve Yahweh." Joshua 24.
There's a wide consensus that the current form of the Hebrew canon received its last major edit in the 6th century BCE, and it was at that point that it was harmonized, monotheized, and this earlier story of contact with Elohim, a species from outer space, was airbrushed out of the picture. Except that the airbrushing is a little too thin. You can still see the vestiges of those earlier stories in the Ten Commandments, in that command from Joshua, in the competition between Yahweh and the other Elohim. We realize that our ancestors were surrounded by another force, more powerful. They formed something called a Sky Council, a group of species, all with a stakeholding in Project Earth, and bumping up against each other in the process. If you enjoy our content here on Fifth Kind TV and would like to support our work, please would you consider subscribing to our new website, fifthkind.tv. Here we will have our full catalog of material along with exclusive access to interviews and documentary content. Sign up today, become part of the community, become part of the conversation. Thank you so much for your support, and I'll see you there.